We're here with Dr. Colby Staubs, and Colby just went out and bought his first home using our real estate strategies. So the bottom line is you were able to buy how much was the house worth? The value of the house.
He was asking $360,000. We got it at $320,000.
Okay.
It was worth more than $360,000.
Okay, so let's say $320,000.
Yeah.
And you only put $20,000 down, right?
Yeah.
Less than 10%. And so you have a $300,000 plus asset for $20,000, and you have now, why is this important? Well, you took $20,000 and created $300,000 out of it. Number one. Number two, you did it without a bank loan, didn't you?
Yeah.
And that's what we teach. Is we teach how to buy real estate without bank loans. And the reason that's so important is bank loans. You're limited to four loans. There's a lot of reasons why, but you're limited to four in today's economy. You're limited to four investment properties. And then it switches to commercial rates. And what that means is you have to put 30% down. So you would be limited very shortly. In other words, if you bought that $300,000+ house and you had to put down $30,000, you would have had to come up with a little over $90,000 to buy that using a bank loan. Do you see how important it is to understand owner financing?
Yep.
And to bypass the banks.
That's the only way I could have done it.
That's right. Now, not only that, but it also helps if you have bad credit. Now, I'm not going to say if you do or don't have bad credit, but you could have bought that house without any credit or bad credit, right? Because he didn't check your credit, did he?
He did check my credit.
Oh, did he? Okay. So he did, which is unusual. Okay. A lot of times, so you don't even have a credit check typically. Did he check your financial ratios?
Nope. The only thing he checked was my credit.
See, so this is another thing that a lot of times chiropractors have bad financial ratios that mortgage companies require to be able to buy a certain amount of home. So you're not stuck with bad credit. You're not stuck with financial ratios, you're not stuck with large down payments, and this is why it is so important to understand how to buy real estate amongst many other factors. But the big factors in addition to that is leverage. So in this case, we took $20,000 and leveraged it into $320,000. And you would not have bought that house if it would not cash flow, right? You already know how to do the financial analysis of a rental home to make sure it cash flows, right?
Yes.
Okay, so Dr. Staubs learned that. So essentially after he buys it, somebody else is paying for his asset. So there's positive cash flow. So there's leverage is number one. So he took $20,000 and made $320,000. Then he has the equity. Every month, people that are his renters are paying into, I call it a mini retirement account is what I call rental homes. So every month he's got somebody else paying into his retirement account. Then he's got appreciation, that home, because you've learned to buy good quality real estate, didn't you?
Yes.
You wouldn't have bought that unless it was a good quality real estate, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, we call that high demand real estate. Otherwise you don't buy it. So that's appreciation. So we know it's a good area, high demand real estate. So that's good appreciation. And then you have depreciation. So that house was 300 and you bought it for 320?
320.
Okay. So divide that over 27 and a half years, you're going to have what? 7,000. I mean, you're going to have $8,000 a year in depreciation taxes. That's $8,000 a year. You take $320,000 divided over 27 and a half years, and that's what the government under United States laws gives you for depreciation. And what that means is that's the amount of money that you don't have to pay taxes on. So let's say it's $8,000 that year. That's $8,000 that you would not have had to pay taxes on as a chiropractor. Now, it's way more than $8,000, remember, because it's not only $8,000, but you would have to pay taxes on $8,000. So if you had to, and you're going to be in a 50% tax bracket after federal, city, state, after you add up all your taxes, you're going to be in a 50% tax bracket. So that $8,000 really would have been $12,000 to have $4,000 to pay taxes, to spend $8,000, and then you'd have to have $24,000. So Colby would have had to have made $24,000 at 50% overhead to have $12,000. to have $4,000 of that go to taxes, to have $8,000 to spend. So the power of just that one category is $24,000 in wages that you don't have to make now. Makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's depreciation, and then there's the cash flow. And the way we teach it, it's a positive cash flow situation, and that's a positive cash flow. But we don't even do it for the cash, right?
No.
I mean, because we're practicing chiropractors, so that cash either goes back into the property to pay it off more, or it goes to buy other properties, because we don't even need the cash. And if you did use it, the next one is it would be capital gains. So that money would be taxed at capital gains rate, not at earned income rate. And that's the power of the wealth strategy of real estate. So in this particular case, there was no bank loan, it was good property, it's called demand real estate. So there's three things that we did that you learned. You learned how to pick the location of a property that's desirable, and you knew all those categories, right? You learned that. Number two is you learned how to evaluate the structure of the property, right? And then you learned how to evaluate the financial package to make it work, right?
Yep.
So you did all three, and then you learned the marketing part of it, right?
Yep.
And okay, so we pick up the house, you put $20,000 down, he picks up a $320,000 cash flowing home. So he just essentially increased his net worth $320,000 from $20,000. That's called leverage of money, good leverage of time and money. And this is why over 70% of the millionaires become millionaires in real estate. So in addition to that, you not only knew location, structure, and financial package, you also didn't have a bank loan, you weren't limited by a bank loan, you would have maybe even not have gotten, would you think you would have even gotten a bank loan?
I don't know, I mean.
You know, because they don't just give them out, yeah. Right? They don't just give out bank loans for, you know, rental properties left and right.
I probably wouldn't have enough down to.
Right, for a bank loan.
With my student loans.
Yeah. And that's the debt income ratio, right? And that's the big problem is the debt income ratio with chiropractors, especially when you add in that student loan factor. That becomes a very limiting factor to buy real estate. So we've over, how many problems did we overcome? A lot.
Yeah.
We overcame all of them, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that's not the knowledge of real estate. So you basically, you do the marketing, you get the, negotiate with the homeowner, $20,000 down, owner financing, make sure the finances create cash flow, you did that, right? And you close on that here in the next few days, right?
Yeah, and it's like 8 days after.
Yeah, and how did that feel to be able to do that? You're only what, how old are you?
33.
So you're already bought your first residential property. How did that make you feel to be able to do that?
It was awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, it's something there, it's gonna be there forever, it's awesome.
Yeah, and how does it feel about creating security for yourself and your family?
Once the deal goes through, I mean, it'll be great. I don't see any hiccups coming through. It's been smooth sailing so far, so yeah.
And then how easy, after you did the first one, how much easier is it you think it is from here forward?
Yeah, it was extremely easy compared to what I thought it was.
Right,
it was
and would you have been able to do any of that without going to my real estate for chiropractors course?
No.
Right, and that's what we do, and that's how I retired at age 33. It was a practice, brought on associate doctors, and invested in real estate, and that's exactly what Dr. Staubs is doing. So, very good. Let's go into the details of it now.
Okay.
So let's start with the marketing. So you evaluated your demand real estate, right? So you picked your neighborhoods.
Yeah, my three neighborhoods.
Okay.
Yep.
And then you picked the specific type of home,
yep.
The structure, right?
Yep, 3-2.
Okay. And square footage, and
yep.
what was high rent probability, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So you knew what the high probability of rent you would need to get to make to cash flow, pay all the bills, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So you start marketing, and the marketing you did is essentially you just called for sale by owners,
yep.
Right? Just called for sale. So you call the for sale by owner, and you went through the flow sheet that we give you a little bit, right?
Kind of. I had my mom do it.
Right.
And she called and she gave me the hot leads. And I.
Okay. So basically, she just called the person, see if it was for sale.
And read your script.
Oh, she read the script.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. pretty good. And she didn't even take the seminar, did she?
Nope.
Okay. So she had a hot lead then, right?
Yep.
So she hands it to you.
Yep.
Okay. And by the way, it's not just something your mom can do. This is an employee can do, anybody. A wife can do. I mean, it's anybody can do this. And let's just say this. Your wife's not trained in real estate, is she?
No.
Or not your wife, your
or
mom.
My mom, no.
Your mom. Yeah, okay. So, okay. She's not a realtor, nothing like that.
No.
You just said, call these numbers and read this script, right?
Yep.
Okay. So you get it. So you make the phone call, right?
Yeah.
And I take it you go through the script and clean it up, right?
Yes.
And nail down everything,
yep,
right?
Exactly what happened.
Okay. So you go through and nail down. And then at the end of that phone call, so he was asking for 360 at the beginning of the phone call?
360 at the beginning of the phone call.
Okay. So and when he you finished with him, you got him down to 320.
330.
So one phone call, you got $30,000 off.
Yep.
And that's what we teach. That's part of our script, how that works. And so you get $30,000 off. And so you see it's a motivated seller. You got owner financing. You got the discounts. Everything's lining up based on the parameters of that of the checklist, right?
Yep.
Okay. So you just followed the checklist, right?
That's all I did.
Okay. And then you go over there, right? And then you just follow the checklist of what to do when you're in front of the homeowner, right?
Yep.
Okay. So did you walk through and look at any repairs?
We went through a lot of them. He had some, you know, there was a couple things on there, but he had a structural report there. And there
okay.
was, you know, some little incidental things.
So you did go, yep. you did go through repairs with
each,
him?
Each room individually.
Okay, like we taught.
Yep.
Okay. And you got him to acknowledge what repairs needed to be done and with rough estimates?
Yep.
Okay, good. Go through that, and then you go through the offers?
The offers.
After you go through the repairs, so you know the cost of the house, you know the value of the house. You'd looked up the value of the house,
yeah,
right?
Yes.
You did the comparables, yes. looked at the county line, see what it appraised for and
yep.
all that. So you know what it's really valued at, so you're not just winging it.
Yep.
So a little bit of knowledge there. And then, so after you do the repairs, then what? And you go over the repairs. What do you do with them next?
We just sat down. I mean, everything fit at that point.
And you made him an offer.
Yeah. Well, I negotiated a little bit more and brought it down another $10,000.
Okay. How'd you do that?
We talked about a little bit about repairs and just said, hey, you know, this is
okay.
kind of where we're at. And
so you follow again. It's following the script.
Yeah.
You followed in line with everything.
Yep.
Got him to admit to everything.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah. Took another $10,000 off.
Okay. Takes you down to 320.
Yeah.
Okay. So you got $30,000 on the phone call, another $10,000 sitting in front of them.
In person, yeah.
So $40,000, not bad, right?
Yep.
So then you make the offer, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And did he bite at it right away?
He was a little hesitant on owner financing at the beginning. And I mean, he needed...
Which is normal,
some
right?
Money, yeah.
And we talk about that. We talk about they do need some money, but they typically don't need the whole amount, right?
Yep. Yeah, that was the thing that took the most skill.
Right.
Was figuring out what he needed.
What he needed. Yeah. Exactly right. And were you able to point out the benefits to him of owner financing?
He had a little knowledge about it because he was like a broker or something
okay.
in his past. So. But, you know, he was hesitant, and then, you know, after we sat down and talked, and he's like, yeah, I would like to stay.
Because remember, all the benefits for him is he doesn't get taxed all at once.
Yep.
He gets a steady paycheck, and if you're older, that's very important to have a steady paycheck. And you can give him a better interest rate than he would be able to get if he took all that money and put it in a CD, right?
Yep.
And was he aware of that?
I think he was.
Did you cover it? So you didn't go that far.
No.
Okay. So you had all these benefits and you didn't even go into all the benefits.
I didn't have to.
And it really got down to finding the good property, structure and location and all that, but then finding the motivated seller.
Yeah. That's
the key. Once you have a motivated seller, your skill level, the amount of your skill level can go down significantly. Did you see that?
Yeah. Thought anybody could have did it.
Right. Huh. Which is true. And I mean, you just have to know how. You got to know the checklist and what to
yes.
do. But that's one of the keys that we talk about is how to find motivated sellers and how to talk to them. So in the one meeting, did he agree to everything in one meeting or did you have several meetings to come to this agreement?
We kind of came to the decision or the the first day.
Right.
The first time I went over there.
You write it down on a legal pad.
We shook hands. I came back on the weekend with my checkbook.
Right.
And we sat down and wrote it out on a legal pad.
Right.
Like a little mini contract. And
right.
It was done.
Yeah, there you go. Pretty exciting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you can see how it's pretty easy probably to pick up 2 homes a year, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I got done with your seminar and I was excited. So I think we picked that up within 30 days of the seminar.
The seminar, yeah, okay. All right, is there anything else you'd like to add to that?
No, I mean, the motivated seller is the number one thing.
Yeah, and remember, how many homes do you need? Well, for a passive income of, you know, and I say this all the time, if you want a passive income of, say, $50,000 just to pay for your expenses, how much money would you have had to have made? You'd had to have made like $8 million at 50% overhead to have $4 million, at 50% in taxes to have $2 million, at a 2 to 3% interest rate to make roughly $50,000. I mean, you'd have to make like $6, $8 million depending on what the interest rate is now. The interest rate now is very low. CDs are 1 and 2%. You know, the average return right now is 2, 3%. So it's very competitive. And it's good for buyers. That's very good for buyers. That's an advantage for buyers. So you go through all the motions. So for you to have $50,000, now how many homes would you need to have? Well, if you're averaging $1,000 per home, that, and let's say it's paid off, because it gets paid off relatively quickly, and we talk about how to accelerate payments and all that stuff. So we teach how to get these homes paid for in 7 years, 10 years, something like that. And so if you have one home giving you $1,000, you'd only need 4 homes to give you roughly $50,000 a year, 4 homes. So what would be easier, 4 homes, and let's say it was $20,000 per home, so that's 2, 4, 6, 80. So it only cost you $80,000. Would only cost you $80,000 with 4 homes to make $50,000 a year versus try to make $6 to $8 million a year.
Yep.
How long was that going to take?
I mean, never.
It's never going to happen. That's why 97% of the doctors can't retire on the same lifestyle, because it's not real. This is real, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, we're so excited. As soon as we close, we're going to start looking for the next one.
Right. Yeah. All right, good job. That was real good. That was the way that's exactly how it's done.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Did you have any questions about his deal, or you want to talk about his deal, any?
Tell me about the resistances you got on financing, what he specifically said when you overcame
him. The biggest thing, you know, he was just a little hesitant. I mean, I had to talk to him about a little bit on what I did then. You know, it did come up that I was a doctor and, you know, I was able to make the payments, and he wanted to run my credit, which was the two biggest things. The last one, I mean, once he was comfortable with my credit, it was pretty smooth. He just didn't want to be in the house anymore. That was the biggest thing.
And was he kind of upside down in equity? Is that why he was so
No, he owned the house outright. His fiance died in the house and he just didn't want to live there anymore. What he did was flipped houses. So he wanted enough money to start his next project and get to his new house.
The motivation was there.
Yep, and he wanted it to make sure that the monthly payments that we had coming in covered his mortgage. And then it was done.
Yeah, and we talk about not just the motivated seller, but they never need all the money. You got to remember that. Nobody needs all the money from selling a house. And so you have to find out, and you got to dig a little bit to find out, well, how much of that money do they really need now? Because that's the money you will have to pay, the money they definitely need now. And it's typically moving costs. Did he say what his was for? Oh, his next project.
His next project, and then so it was like $20,000 that he was going to use to get into
the next house.
Flip,
okay.
He was doing.
And then
just as long as the rent we were paying, or the payments we were paying him, covered his mortgage, so he didn't want to have the payment going out.
Right.
And the deal was done.
And so that's a big thing, is finding out the amount of money that they need. That's the amount of money that gets put down. with the equity now's. And then the other big ones are they're not hit with taxes. Remember, if they're motivated, the next three things I'm getting ready to say don't matter. But they're very supportive. No taxes, so they don't get hit with all the taxes immediately if they're in that type of situation. The money they do get that they don't need, they're going to spend, what are they going to do with it? It's typically dead money. They're typically going to put it in a CD for 2% interest rate. It's dead money. So we can typically give them a greater interest rate than anywhere else they'd put that money. We point that out to them. It's still secure. It's still secure, just as secure as money in a CD, because the house has insurance. So and he's listed on the insurance, just like he's the mortgager is what he is. Even though he's the owner, this guy's holding the note, so he's acting as the bank. So just like a bank would say, well, we want this insured. Well, it would be insured, and he would be listed. He would be listed also as the payoff minus the debt of the home. So that gives him security for damage on the home if anything happens there. So you got taxes, you got money to move, you got taxes benefits, you got interest rate benefits, you got security. These are all the, and then a monthly payment, because a lot of times the people we look for, remember there's four cycles to buying a house. There's four levels of buying a house, from the starter home to the step home, up home, to the dream home, to the step down home. So there's four home buying cycles. So a lot of times it's good to buy the home at the end where the person is now stepping down, meaning they don't need the money. In other words, they don't need the money to go to another house, to put into another house, and have a bigger mortgage and things like that. So it's good when they don't need the money. So that's helpful for older people. And they get the stability of a check in the mail. And these are all the things that have to be discussed to some degree. And again, how much those are important: taxes, percent return, security, regular payments. How much those are important is totally dependent on the need. Now, if I have somebody who doesn't have high need at all, I can still logically take them through that cycle and make it worth their while. But it takes more skill level and more finesse, and it usually takes more contacts, not just one.
Yeah.
So you can still buy the houses that way with lower need or no need, because it still makes way more sense than what they're about to do.
Yeah.
Also not having to deal with a realtor and closing costs and all that stuff, and it sells now. So these are all the benefits to them. And then if there's higher need, all of those things that I just said become less and less important, to not even important at all, the higher the need is. And in this case, you said his need was the pain. He wanted to get out of the house. He needed some transfer money to move and to do his next flip home. And what was important to him is that the check that he got in the mail from you for the payment covered what he was going. So essentially, he's not paying for his mortgage.
He's making a little bit of money.
Right. It works for everybody, right? So.
There, was paid off.
There you go.
It was. So,
but finishing
the new house that he was moving to, he had to get a mortgage on because he didn't sell the house out.
So you just had to make sure.
He had to give him $300,000. His new house that he was moving to, he had to get a mortgage on. Does that make sense?
So he wanted your money to make the mortgage payment on that house.
Yeah.
He wanted the mortgage, the payments that we were making to him monthly to pay off the house that I'm buying.
Right.
Covered the mortgage that he was getting on his new house.
So from our perspective, whether somebody just wanted to get out and be away from it because they owed money, or this guy had different motivations.
You always have to find the motivation. You always have to find their needs, and then you have to go to meet their needs.
Yeah, it wasn't a financial need for him. It was more of an emotional one, a need than anything.
Well, there was a little bit of financial. He didn't want to be stuck with a payment, a house payment on his own house.
I mean,
so there's a little bit of a financial.
He could have stayed in the house because it was paid off.
Yeah, but I mean, for him to do the deal, there was a financial component. That check had to be big enough to pay for his mortgage where he was moving to.
Yeah.
So
you're,
how did it fit? Me?
Yeah.
33?
33. So you got is this a 30-year deal with him or something? Or
He structured his 30-year note with us to be able to pay it off early.
Okay. So that, I mean, the long-term thing is you just keep paying, you have a renter in there, and then you'll have it for retirement.
Yeah.
Once it's paid off, then it's going to be good for you 30 years from now.
No, it's not 30 years from now. No, let me go into that. There's several strategies to where you don't wait 30 years. One strategy is every month there's an additional principal payment made. Now, if you do that on a 30-year note, it'll drop it down. That alone drops it down to, I think, between 17 and 22 years. If it's a 15-year note, it drops it down to like 10 to 12 years.
What's the strategy? You make an extra principal payment?
Well, I'm going to go through them all right now. So one of the strategies is you make an extra principal monthly payment, principal only, no interest, principal only interest. That will drop down a mortgage, like I said, a 30-year note down to 20, 22 years alone, that alone.
17.
Yep. Yeah. There's
one extra payment a year?
No, yeah. One principal payment. Principal, no interest, yeah, principal.
One principal payment per year will drop that.
No, per month. Okay, so that's one simple strategy. The next strategy is the cash flow. You shouldn't need the money. That's what's great about chiropractic. He's making money in his chiropractic office. He shouldn't need any money from real estate. I didn't have to use any of my money from real estate. And I say this all the time. And the money that he cash flows with, after it pays for maintenance, taxes, insurance, mortgage, all that, that amount of money, he should not just spend on a vacation or a Ferrari. That money, you should do one of two things. Dump it back into that house.
For the extra payment.
Yeah. Yep. Or put it in an escrow account to help build an escrow account to go buy another house. Now, with how young Kobe is, Kobe would not want to. He's 33. 33? He would not want to put that money back into that house right now because he's got time on his side. He would want to just take that money and put it into an escrow account and help build that little nest to go do it again. That's the strategy he should use because of his age. And then the third strategy, so that's three strategies. The next strategy is you just keep buying several of these homes. Well, 5 years from now or 7 years from now or 10 years from now, let's say you got 10 homes. Well, they're all creating value between appreciation and equity down payment. All of these homes are creating value. So if you've got 10 years from now, say you only did one home a year, can you see how like ridiculous it is for me to say one home a year now?
Yeah.
That's like if you're real slow.
Yeah, I mean, feel like you should at least pick up
it. I always say you should do two a year minimum, two a year. So let's say you got 10 homes after 10 years. Take five of those homes and sell them off. Take the equity from those and throw it into the existing homes, and that creates your cash flow situation of whatever it is that you need. If you totally want to stop working and only want to live off the money from your rentals. So there's several strategies.
Oh, I see. It's not like you just stick with the same homes throughout the whole thing. You can move things.
Well, you always want to keep the home, always, unless. And I mean, this is not about buying and selling homes. That is not what this is about. That doesn't do anything for you. This is about long-term investments. There's really only a couple times when you sell a home. One is when that neighborhood over time becomes a B and C and D neighborhood. In other words, it's turning into a bad area with drugs and crime and crap, you know, over time. And this is why it is so important you buy property right in your backyard so you see all this happening. So if you have a property and it's starting to mosaic over there, you're starting to see crime get into it and, you know, bad gringos going into this area, then you want to 1099 that property. So you sell it, but what you do is you sell it and you 1099 it, you sell the property. And you go and buy another property in a good area, and essentially you're transferring the asset and the finances and everything without any tax ramifications from a bad area into a good area.
You're just transferring the
property. Yeah, yeah. So you do that, Or let's say you started out and you bought some lower end homes. Well, down the road, you may want to upgrade those homes, so you'll 1099 those too. You don't sell them. It is a sale. It's a sale, but it's a non-taxable transaction.
Right, you're doing when you do it, property.
When you do 1099, it's 1099. It's a non-taxable entity, and all you're doing is transferring it from here to another investment property. So it's not like you're selling the property. You never want to sell property. So that it's either bad area, or you want to upgrade. Now instead of like lower homes, because lower homes and lower rents will attract lower quality people. You go to nice neighborhoods, higher neighborhoods, they'll attract higher quality renters. That's why they say you buy in, when you buy a house, you kind of buy in your renters.
Now when you start this school,
let me finish this. So that's another, so it's bad area. Let's say you bought low because you started,
right?
Which you may have to. Maybe you have a little less money or whatever, for whatever reason. You didn't have the knowledge, whatever. And then you just kind of buy up over time. You 1099, you buy up. Or down the road, like I said, you want to create more of a cash flow. Go ahead and sell some off, take the equity and throw it into some of your other existing properties to create larger cash flows. Those are the three common areas that you would sell a home, and that's really it. Otherwise, you should be keeping your homes.
So, Colby, to start off, you had to use money you made in chiropractic.
Yeah, I used my own money. I didn't quite understand the paperwork. I was going to try to maybe do it through my retirement account, but I didn't quite understand the paperwork. And I didn't want to lose the deal by hesitating, so I just cut him a check out of my personal account and started it.
Well, and Paul, what's your recommendation about using our own money versus, I mean, I know maybe to get started, but what's your recommendation on how much money should we have to use on our own money versus what we create in real estate, I guess?
Well, the short answer is you never want to use any of your money. I mean, that's what everybody always tries to, is never use any of your money, use other people's money to leverage deals. I mean, that's the ultimate goal, but that's not really what chiropractors in real estate are. That's what I talked about. If you're a full-time real estate investor, you know these strategies and you're learning them and things like that. But real estate investing for chiropractors makes it real simple to buy real estate. And so what I've always said is chiropractors should have a little bit of disposable income. I mean, a chiropractor should come up with $20,000 in 1, 2, 3, or 4 months in disposable income. If he's not, he doesn't know what he's doing in his office. He's got to learn how to run a business. So the chiropractor should easily be able to come up with, $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 to buy real estate owner financed on his own. And then what makes it real sweet is when you have an associate doctor, then you just take the associate doctor's money and you use his money that he made and buy real estate.
I got what you're saying. You're making money. What, you going to go use it to spend it all, or are you going to put it in for your future?
Yeah, I had it. It was just
the 20 grand he has versus having to make $8 million to do what you're doing.
I always suggest have a efficient lifestyle, and then every time, whether it's 1 month, depends on how much money you're making, whether it's 1 month or 2 months or 3 months, you just take that money and you now go look for another piece of property. So let's say you're a chiropractor and you're only profiting $1,000 or $2,000 a month after you paid everything, right? Well, go ahead and save up your money for 4, 5, 6 months, come up with $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 and go buy a house. That's what I recommend. If you make more, if your profit is $20,000 a month or 30, go pick up 2 or 3 houses a month. That's what I did. I just went out every time I had X amount of money, when I was making 7-figure income, I just went out and bought more property every month.
How much cash did you have to come up with?
$20,000.
Is that quite a bit for one property? More than you have typically
heard? A little more, but it's a $320,000 property.
Yeah, it's a really nice plot.
That's a good neighborhood, $320,000. That's less than 10%.
And it's not in a flood zone, and it's across the street from the water, like the ocean. It is nice.
And it's a starter home, though?
No, it'd be more of a you know, like a step-up home. Like, it, I mean, it's there for a family to live in. It's not going to be, you know, a kid and or a baby and probably a
I guess I just thought everything home. I heard from before, we're supposed to be getting starter homes, less money.
It was the deal that was available, and, you know, and it fit. It was
the
everything
fit. Still the same. It's still going to be in your retirement account.
Yeah, everything fit. I mean, it's going to be rents in that area go anywhere from like $1,500 would be a low end house up to $22,000. My payment to break even would be about $15,000. I mean, I can get $18,000 without even blinking
an eye. That sounds like a step up home.
Yeah.
No. I said percentages. Percentages, you're going to have higher percentage in starter homes, lower percentage in step-up homes, and very low percentages in your McMansion, you know, home of my dreams. It's not black or white. It's probabilities versus possibilities and percentages. That's what it is.
Yeah, it fit, all the numbers fit, so we just pulled the trigger.
The best homes to go into are the middle, upper-class, white-collar homes. Those are the neighborhoods. Those are the best, you'll get the best renters, the easiest, but they cost more. They're gonna cost a little more to get in than a blue collar starter home.
Yeah, I got to tell you that because you buy your renter
meeting. Yeah, that's always.
Yeah,
this, I mean, always.
It's the nicest school district.
That's why we pay so much attention into demand real estate. You better be marketing in and know your criteria for what's called demand real estate.
Yeah, we went through all that. Good job, Kobe. That's awesome.
Yeah, it was shockingly easy.
That's a big balls for you to spend $20,000 on your first deal, like your own money. But I know it makes sense.
It's
not for a $320,000 home. I mean, that's like sweet. Yeah. And that's every month. I mean,
interesting. I always thought, like, because I don't know much about real estate, but I always thought, like, you know, you got to have somebody in distress. They got to, and they're financially under. This guy owned it, but it still made sense for him to sell it.
Remember, about 22% of the homes are paid for in full.
Yeah, I mean,
an older person that's stepping down, that's the best deal he'll get is dealing with me or a real estate investor like me. He won't have to pay taxes all at once. I'm going to give him a better interest rate. He's going to get a monthly check, and it's secured. That is the best deal he's going to get. He will not, if he goes on his own, He's going to have a higher probability of taxes, depending on his situation, et cetera. Then he's going to have, when he does get the money, he's going to have low possible interest rate. Remember, when you're older too, you don't go into the stock market. You go into conservative stuff. You don't want to risk anything when you're older.
And he's not paying those real estate fees.
So he's going to get a greater, I'll be able to give him a better price and better terms as if he were to just go out and sell it on his own. And a lot of the common people, you know, it kind of sets in. When they're not motivated, you can still get these older people to see it, especially if they're not, like, remember, they're going down, they're not going up. They don't need the money, they're not buying up, their family's gone. Right? Those are great situations. And then you talk to them a few, usually it takes a couple contacts. Because remember, the world has been trained to do what? Hire a realtor and sell the house. That's all they know. So when you say anything different, like it freaks people out. Yeah, so you got to go through steps. And there you go. That's how it's done. And remember, 10% of the market, I couldn't cite a research or anything, but I'd easily say 10% of the market's in distress. You know, 10% of the people selling homes, there's problems going on. They're getting a divorce, they got to move, they can't afford the house. I mean, there's stuff going on. I mean, it is never pristine. Everybody selling their house is not in a perfect situation. And that's how easy that was, phone call. And that's the difference between advertising, because I show you advertising methods, but you already know advertising is a very low probability. See, that was being proactive.
Yeah.
You will always, but the difference between being proactive, you know, you got mailings, so it's passive, so you're a chiropractor, you can just do the mailings, but it's very lower percentages.
Right.
Then there's the intermediate, the assistant, and that's kind of what he did. The assistant that's proactive. So now it's not taking your time, but you're proactive. He never would have gotten that with a mailing.
No. And I would have, if I would have waited any longer, the thing would have been gone.
Yeah. And that's the other thing. You got to know.
So you signed it back.
Wait a minute. Here's the third part. As being a full-time chiropractor, then it's you doing the proactive things, which give you the highest probability, but now they take up your time. See, that's the balancing act. And that's why I always say the assistant, you have your right-hand person, your marketing assistant, and that is the person that helps you do all this stuff. You leverage your time through them, but yet it's proactive, so it's way more effective than mailings.
You use your marketing assistant in your office to do your
research, yeah,
honey?
Yeah. I always have a personal assistant. At some point, you have to have a personal assistant that helps you not only with your business but your life. If you're an entrepreneur, I had my personal assistant do my personal parties. My personal assistant did everything. There gets to be a point where you have to have a personal assistant because you have limited time and effort and energy.
Leverage.
Yeah, it's all leverage. And that's why I say one of the first things you should do after you know how to maximize your exchange of time for money is you have a personal assistant. And I typically have the top person in my office, you know, the person who really is a go-getter and knows her stuff. They're not only the marketing assistant, they're like, hey, let me pay you a little more and you can be my personal assistant to help me in my personal life, my real estate, you know, all the basically everything else in my life. And that's what I did.
Does that cause problems if you're paying them on payroll and deducting it and then they're doing personal stuff for you? Is that an IRS thing?
Well, when I say personal, my personal stuff is business.
Yeah,
that party I told you about was a business party.
They're not going to do it your grocery shop.
No. I do have assistants to do that, but that's not tax deductible. Yeah, I had a chef and I had a house cleaning lady, and that's just not tax deductible.
So Colby, you signed a note with him. He had you sign a note.
Yeah, we signed the contract, and I gave him a check. He cashed a check, and the contract was legal.
So that was it that big lengthy one, or was the quick one?
It was like a one-page.
You never do. You've learned this. You were in the real estate. You never hand somebody a 12-page contract.
It went so fast because my mom's moved down to help my sister out with her baby, so she just walks the neighborhoods that I do because she walks because she's retired and wants to get exercise. The sign went in the yard. We called. I think
for sale by owner.
Yep, for sale by owner went in the yard. We called probably within 24 hours, and that thing, probably within 3 days, we had a contract signed. And he was getting calls after.
Yeah, properties go fast. You gotta cut the deal. You cannot be antsy. You gotta know how to make a decision.
Yeah, it went real fast.
And you now what's the risk to him if you don't make the payments? He just gets the house back.
Yeah.
That's what the contract.
Now, there's one other caveat, and I don't say it unless I'm seeing they're hesitant with that. The next thing that I'll do is I'll offer to put the deed in escrow and what that does. Now, I don't offer it unless I see they're having a lot of security issues with if they bring up anything about foreclosure, not making payments in foreclosure and the time and money and all that. Then what I do is I go, okay, here's what we can do to handle that. We'll just put a deed in escrow. So in other words, we take the deed and put it in escrow. And within 30 days, if it's not paid, if it's delinquent after 30 days, the deed reverts right back to him. And everything's already signed. It's all pre-signed. And that protects him where he does not have to do a foreclosure because a foreclosure can take up to 2 years with no payments and all that.
Yeah, we didn't have to do that.
Right. And I won't advertise that.
Bring
it up. I won't advertise it unless they say, well, I'm not going to do that because then I'd have to foreclose on you and that'd take two. In other words, if they knew something about foreclosure, that I have the strategy to support them. And really, if I have no counter intentions, what do I care?
Yep. And so I was going to bring that up, but as soon as he saw my credit score,
so
all that was done.
You signed the contract with him, but if something happened, it doesn't affect your credit. It wouldn't hurt you. It would just, you would just lose what you put into the property.
Yeah, pretty much.
But you didn't. You're not signing.
What do you mean if something would happen? What are you worried about?
If something happened.
Like what?
He couldn't make the payments.
Like how? Why wouldn't he be able to make the payments?
I don't know. Shit happens in life. If he got hurt or he couldn't work or.
He's not making the payments.
Well, I know he's got the renter.
Why wouldn't he be able to make the payments? He already did his due diligence. It's demand real estate. Okay, so why wouldn't somebody make the payments?
Well, it'd be rare that he couldn't get a renter and was not working.
And let's say worst case scenario, you can't get a renter. What's the easiest way to get a renter?
Drop the price.
Yeah. So what's easier? Drop the price and get the and steal a renter from somebody else and maybe me eat $200 or $300 a month temporarily for my investment?
It's easy.
Or lose the whole deal. This is like no-brainer stuff. That's why I say it's real estate investing for chiropractors. Meaning, if you have a little bit of disposable cash, this is a great way to invest in real estate.
Right. You're not taking these big risks.
Am I going to be stuck for a negative? Because we don't get into a negative cash flow situation in the first place. You should never do that.
And it's high demand, so you're not going to be in a bad area where nobody wants to rent.
It's great demand. I mean,
the rental's already calculated in with the percentage of vacancy also. So there's all these tie-ins, but every now and then, yeah, am I going to worry about it? Well, if I'm worried about it a month or two of not paying rent, first of all, I'm going to be in high demand area, so that shouldn't happen. Worst case scenario, I'm just going to drop the price and steal a renter that was going to go in somebody else's. I mean, that's why when I keep hearing this risk stuff, people are so scared of real estate. I'm like, what are you talking about? It's real. That's why they call it real estate. I'd be more worried about your practice than I would that real estate. Let me tell you. Your practice is way more vulnerable than that piece of real estate he just got.
Well, the only risk I can really foresee is the one you said is minimal, is no renter.
The risk is when you don't know demand real estate structure and financial packages. That's when it's all risk. If you know those, there's like little to no risk. And the great thing about real estate is it recovers. Time almost cures all real estate problems. Time does. So.
But even if he's not going to sell the property, so if there's a crash or something and the market drops, it doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
You're renting it out and it's part of your retirement. You don't care.
Don't matter. Yep.
You're not trying to flip it and the profit and then you're stuck with $100,000. Yeah. It doesn't happen to you.
No. He just wants it to break even. He doesn't. To be honest with you don't even care if it cash flows. We want it to, but we don't even care. Just as long as it breaks even, even if he has to put a month or two, somebody doesn't rent. Remember, but the more you do your due diligence, the more it's renting.
And I see the more you start doing this, you start creating positive cash flow situations in other homes. You're using that to make extra equity payments on other ones. So you just get, you work the whole thing down.
That's what I always did. I just took the money that came off that property and I put it into the principal of that property. That's what I did. Because I had good cash flow. You have good cash flow, I'm just taking, every month I just took out my cash flow and went and bought properties. That's all I did. That's all I did. And then the cash flow that the properties did have, every month, whether it was $100, $200, whatever, I just dumped it right back into the principal. And it just shoots down it increases the equity.
You're doing really well in your practice and let's say a month you got extra $5,000-$10,000. You can either use that to make the equity payments extra or go buy.
You would never do that. You would never do that. You would never put $5,000 of your money into an equity payment.
So you're using the cash flow from the property to make the extra equity.
Yes.
Yep. So he may not be able to.
There's no way I'm going to take $5,000 and tie it up into a property when I could have just leveraged it for $100,000. There's no way.
So you're only using your cash flow from the property.
Yeah.
To make the extra equity payments.
Yeah.
Okay. So he's.
But when you're that young, you don't care to. Like I told him, I said, when you're that young, you got time on your side.
Yeah.
I don't know. I told him. I said, what he should do is take the equity and put it into an escrow account And as that ball gets bigger, between that ball and whatever he adds to it, go buy it, go do it again. That's what he should do because he's got time.
I'm 16 years older than him, so I'd be a little different.
Well, you still got time. Yeah. You're not going to need money until you're 65. Unless you want to.
49.
Unless you want to do something. I'm just going to tell you, I never touched any of my real estate money. I never needed it. Why? I had my practice and I had my associate doctors. I never needed my real estate money. Never.
But that was your nest egg?
Yeah. Huge security. That was wealth, passive income, huge security. Way more. That's why I say that piece of real estate he bought is way more secure than a practice. A chiropractic practice? Come on. How quickly can they change the insurance laws or whatever?
Yeah, so I mean, the changes of personal injury laws.
People think their practice is security. That's not security. I had a client just broke his wrist. Yeah. Tell me, and you know, he's running for an associate doctor. Tell me how secure he is for paying his bills right now with a broken wrist in a chiropractic office. That's not security. Said that's why you should have had associate doctors, and that's why you should be buying real estate. That's security.
Yeah, I know a doctor. He tore some ligament in his wrist, and he can't practice anymore. It's like permanent damage. Now, he was older. But
people do this all the time. They do. I mean, fortunately, I learned early, real early. All good stuff. And then chiropractic is in the rearview mirror. Chiropractic is the vehicle. The vehicle. Now to create wealth. It's not the end all. And then as soon as he already had that one associate set up. He's looking for his next associate. And then boom, there you go. He'll just start working part-time. And then one of two things happen. Most people, when they start working part-time, they don't start screwing off. When you know this much information, you don't start wasting it. Typically what happens now is you start bringing on more associates, training more doctors, opening offices, and buying more real estate. You're way more valuable out of that office buying real estate or training associate doctors than in that office adjusting spines. It's the lowest form of income you will ever make. Exchanging your time for money, adjusting spines. It's the worst, lowest form of money you will ever make.